version, we have our group PI06, and our project is about repurposing used lithium ion batteries. So this is the table of contents. Firstly, I'll go through the breakout information, followed by our project objective. I'll then talk about the charging system and the self-balancing feature. Then NC will share more about the discharging system, and we'll show any of the monitoring system and the conclusion. So some background information. The look at there is an increasing amount of EV vehicles on the road. So this is because more and more people are trying to go towards a more sustainable mode of transportation. So this is driven by environmental consciousness and the intent to mitigate climate change. So we all know EVs do not produce carbon dioxide, and because of the Singapore 2030 Green Plan, the number of EVs on the road is expected to increase in the future. So when these batteries cannot be used for EVs, right, they will either be disposed of, dismantled for their components, or repurposed for second life, for less demanding second life applications, like powering up lighting circuits or using them for energy storage solutions. So by repurposing, one can aim to reduce the investment cost and mitigate environmental pollution. So our future objective is to perform technical diagnostics and monitor battery metrics such as battery temperature, battery voltage, current, throughout the charging and discharging process using the MPU. So we will measure battery statistics such as battery voltage, battery current, surface temperature of the cell, ambient temperature, state of charge, and the total time taken to charge and discharge the battery pack. In the event of an abnormal condition, we will also send an SMS to the tester and it will trip the alarm to the buzzer. So this is the system overview of our project. And this is the image of our setup, which you'll get to see more in the project demo later on. So the power supply system, this is the power supply that I'm using from Tenma. The reason why I chose this is because of its high power output and it's highly accurate, up to 1 mV and or 1 mA. It's also a built-in over current, over voltage and over temperature protection, and offers three different type of interfaces. The interface that I use to program the power supply using that view is the USB interface. So for the batteries, because we don't have second life batteries right now, so we are using new batteries. And the capacity of this battery is 3,350 mAh, and the nominal voltage is 3.6 volts. The charging voltage is 4.2 volts. So this is the schematic of our project. We have two DC2598 blocks. One block can measure up to 12 cells, so it measures the voltage of the cell. So we are using two boards, and the configuration for our batteries is 12S2P. So we have two strings of 12 cells in the series. So we have built in the e-stop and fuse for the potential system, and also relays to control the monitoring, charging and discharging process. So the method of charging that I programmed onto the power supply using the MPU is the constant current, constant voltage charging. The reason why I chose this is because it's the most widely used method in the industry and can be found in most modern battery chargers. So the first stage is the constant current mode, and then you switch over to the constant voltage mode. I'll share more about this using the graph later on. So this is the flow chart for the program. When it detects the voltage under 4.2 volt, it will start charging. However, if the battery is under 3 volt, which means that it's over discharged, you will first go through a pre-charge mode. And once it exceeds 3 volt, you will go back to the normal constant current mode. And once it reaches 4.2 volts, that's when you will switch over to the constant voltage mode. And when the current that is drawn is less than the cutoff current that we set in the program, it means that the charging is completed and the charging procedure will stop. So these are some of the lab view codes that are programmed. And this is the charging dashboard. So on the left here, you will be able to monitor, look at the battery voltage, the current, the voltage waveform and the current waveforms. So at the bottom is where you will show the state of charging that is at right now. So this is the charging curve that we have gotten from the data sheet itself. So you'll be able to compare this with the data that I get later on. So this is the data that I got using the power supply, so it's actually the same. So for the first 110 minutes, it's actually the constant current mode. And you'll notice that the voltage rises from 2.9 volt to around 4.2 volt. After that, you switch over to the constant voltage mode, and you'll see that the current drops from around 600 mA to around 4% of 700 mA. That's where the charging is completed. So the total time taken to charge is around 5 hours at 0.2C, which is around 0.68 amps. So I'll move on to self-balancing feature. So what is self-balancing? It's actually the process of incrementing the charge in the series connected battery pack. So right now there are two main methods of charge of active balancing. One is active and one is passive. So the one that we have chosen is active balancing. So there are two types. So one is inductive and one is capacitive. So So we are using energy storage components, either an inductor or a capacitor, to transfer a charge from a high SOC cell to a low SOC cell. So this is very efficient because we are using the energy within the battery pack. However, this comes with a higher cost because the components needed for effective balancing will be quite expensive. So for passive balancing, it's the cheaper option. So we are using a shunt resistor to burn off the excess charge. So this is a very straightforward method. It's suitable for low cost applications. However, because we are burning off the charge using a resistor, it will actually generate a lot of heat. So this will have an impact on battery time because we are burning off the charge. So the one that we have chosen is the active balancing multi-inductor stabilizer. So we have a quicker equalization time, requires less components, and it's more efficient as compared to capacity balancing, which is around 50% efficiency. So however, this may have a long balancing time, if cells with different SOC are hard. So this is the schematic in the active balancing. So if cell C1 is higher SOC than cell C2, we will close off or switch S1, and the charge will get transferred from the cell to the inductor. After that, we will switch over the switch and we will close S2 instead, and the charge will get transferred from the inductor to cell C2. So this is the board that we have chosen for the project. And it uses the ETA3000 IC chip. So this chip will control the turning on and off the switch for us. And one chip is in charge of balancing two cells. So when it detects a voltage difference of more than 0.1 volt, it will automatically turn on and it will help us to balance the two cells. So for example, if cell C1 and C4 has different SOC, right? Cell 4 has to balance cell 3, and cell 3 has to balance cell 2. So this is the only downside of this balancing board. So this is the data that we've gotten from the monitoring system. So you can see that at the start, it's around 3.2 to 3.9 volts. And after 1 hour, you balance all the cells to around 3.7 volts. So these are some of the images of the cabinet itself. So this acrylic board here is actually laser cut, and we actually designed and laser cut this acrylic board. So this is the board that is capable of monitoring 12 cells each. And this is the battery box itself. The red tape is pasting the thermistors on the surface of the cell. And this is the smoke sensor. This is the temperature and humidity sensor. This is the active balancing board. And this is the fan. So these are the relays that's connected in between the batteries and the relays itself. And the batteries and the voltage measuring board. And this is the battery box, which you can see more later on. So I'm going to ask my time here to share more about the battery discharge test.
Thank you, Joel. So now we're talking about battery discharge test. First, the process of battery discharge test will have the performance, capacity and of the battery during the cell and releasing energy from the battery.
So the
equipment I use to conduct battery discharge is a
programmable
inductor. So this is called a coma. So here I have high range of 300 output power, low range of 30 watt output power.
And the three more of us we use is a constant current, constant voltage and constant resistor.
Focus is more on constant current. Later on, I share more about in the flowchart itself. So this is flowchart discharging. So how it initiates? So after we initiate the channel itself and the mode like constant current, constant voltage and constant resistor. But our main focus is on constant current. Why? Because constant current has to control the flow of current from the battery smooth without any damaging the battery. If we're using constant voltage or constant resistor, it may lead to increase in a sudden increase in the current, and this current will heat up the battery easily and cause risk to us. So after set up, the load itself will measure the voltage on the battery. Whether the voltage above the cut point or below the cut point. If once the voltage reaches the cut point, the program will stop. Why? This one will prevent battery being over-discharged, which will damage your battery. If not, the battery, if the voltage above the cut point, it will continue to discharge at the constant current. When the preset current has over at set 1 ampere. So the current will keep going at 1 ampere. And this, all the data will store inside the data log in the test file. And this program will keep repeat the cycle until the voltage reaches a cut point and the program will stop. And from there we can get a discharge curve on the battery. So this is some of the hardware connection that we use. The electronic load itself. And you connect to a battery board with the monitoring. And later I'll show more in the demo. So this is a discharging test board with four channels itself. You can monitor four strings at the same time. Also there's a stator for us. So there's a stator for us to tell us what kind of mode is it, but our main focus more on constant current because we want to ensure the battery is safe. Also the four channel ensure that the battery is cut off when the boat can cut safely when it reaches a cut off. So these are the setup, the function itself. So this is the main setup. So after we set up the channel itself and the mode, with a preset current itself. So program start running and start discharging.
So also there's temperature monitoring, right?
Because temperature is one of the very important factors to affect the battery discharge time.
If the battery is too high,
it may cause a loss of the battery and
battery will heat up easily.
Therefore, we need to monitor the ambient temperature surrounding.
So some of the results are achieved by discharging.
You see the there are discharge, state of charge and capacity from the battery. Also the internal resistance from the battery. Because these are all the factors that affect the battery performance for repurposing.
So what we mean by battery state of discharge? It means how much battery actual power can be saved used from the battery. And based on industry reference, 80% of the discharge formula are used to greater battery from manufacturer. Why this one can't protect battery from being overused? So what's the difference between battery capacity and state of discharge? Battery capacity basically refers to total energy supply from battery when 100% charge, fully charged. So the efficient rate is current times the total time for the battery. So what is delta charge? Delta charge basically means the battery uses how much energy you can safely use from the battery without compromising the lifespan. So equation to find out delta charge using the discharge current over the total time in hours. And then after you go divide by your rated capacity. And this amount of capacity basically is how much energy can save you from the battery. So what's the difference between state of charge and delta charge? State of charge basically is the inverse of delta charge, so it means that opposite the remaining amount of energy in the battery. And this amount of energy is used to protect the battery itself. So equation is that just 1 minus delta charge. So for example, the battery rated 80% delta charge, so it does mean. So only that means you only can use 80% of energy from the battery. Example for a battery, you are with the capacity is 3.35 mAh. So means you only can use out 2.68 mAh to work 80% delta discharge. So the remaining amount of energy is stored in the battery to protect the battery life. So this is a test we conducted with 3.35 mAh lithium-ion battery. So the discharge time is about 1.1 mAh, and we took like 2.5 hours to fully discharge and do count point of 2.5 hours. And this is how to find the capacity, usable capacity from battery. So using this usable capacity over the rated capacity, you can get 70%, 78.5% delta discharge. Basically, this is the amount of energy you can be safely used from battery. The remaining amount of state of charge energy is to help that battery from being over discharged. So average recommended state of discharge from battery, for lead acid 50%, AGM battery 80%, gel battery 70%, and more important for us using lithium ion battery from 80% to 100%. So we don't exceed this amount, it's safety, the battery will be safe. So this is a sample curve from the manufacturer side of the battery that we have been used with different discharge rate and the power point. And this is a test we conducted using the electronic load program. And you can see the curve is matched with the manufacturer side, therefore this proves us that our battery, our program is successfully programmed. So why higher delta charge is better? Because higher delta charge means we can use our battery longer before we recharge it. So this, as long as we recharge lesser, we can protect our battery also. So next I'll talk about internal resistance. So what is internal resistance? Internal resistance basically the battery in contact is a different current in open circuit time. So low internal resistance will have enhanced efficiency and voltage stability during the usage. For example, our phone, usually have a new phone, right? No matter how long we use, like, the phone won't heat up, right? Because the battery is new, therefore it doesn't really won't, there's no lesser losses. But after a certain period, the battery gets older and older, and it reduces the performance, right? The internal resistance of the battery will change due to the chemical component inside changes. And the battery will easily heat up, right? Because the internal resistance is higher and there's more losses, and battery will heat up, same as our phone. After a period, right after we heat up, right? Because the internal resistance of the battery is rising up. So there are three methods to measure internal resistance: DC load, AC conductor, and EIS. But our main focus, the current method we're using, the DC load method itself. So this one, usually battery is always in the open circuit voltage. But once we connect it to the load itself, the voltage go to the load, the terminal voltage. And using this one, you can find the current from drawn to the load itself by Ohm's law. And you can find the internal resistance across the internal resistance, voltage across the internal resistance using Q-core voltage or using open circuit voltage of battery to weigh the terminal voltage from the load. And the remaining voltage is drawn to the load itself. It's a battery internal resistance voltage. So after we can use this Ohm's law again to find the internal resistance of battery. So this sample of test we connected also. So actually, battery is in the open circuit voltage time. But after you connect to the load, when the load is open, there's a sudden drop in the voltage, right? When this voltage is a working voltage to the terminal voltage, out of the electrical load itself. And this, the sudden drop in the default voltage, we see the voltage that dropped by the internal resistor itself. And this is a curve that I showed. When doing the state of raising energy from battery, the internal resistor will increase. Why? Because the battery gets heated up easily. And also, this will change the physical component of battery inside the battery. And the internal resistor eventually rises up. As a curve of battery, battery without internal resistor is very smooth curve. But with the battery, the internal resistor in new battery is very small internal resistor. But aging battery, the internal resistor is bigger, therefore there's more losses. And this is a sample of test we did. You see that discharge and there's a rise in internal resistor, therefore it put back that. The internal resistor will increase when the battery